Hello, everybody. Sir Walter, the Sir Walter Jones Show. It is the weekend edition. Hey, Sunday, April 2nd, 2017. It is 8:33 in the p.m., and many of the church folk have been to church today, and some of you have night services. You're there at your church giving God the praise until you get tired and put that Baptist finger up. Well, it's cold again, Baptist. That Pentecostal finger, you put that up, and then you say, I got to go. Bye-bye. All right, we got another controversial topic today that will probably upset quite a few of you because many of you have people in your lives in whom you call apostle. Apostle. I have friends, many friends that are called apostles. And if you Google apostle, you will find, well, if you just put it in the Facebook search, you will definitely find an unlimited amount of, I just typed in apostle on Facebook, okay? And let me help you out here. For those of you who may not understand what I'm getting ready to do here, don't get alarmed. I ain't going to upset your apostles, okay? Because there are many Jesuses and the apostles of old are dead. Well, Phil, you said it. I didn't say it. You said it. Okay? Let me show y'all my search. I just did this live on the air. All right? I hit apostle up here, okay? And this is what I get. Y'all see that, right? Oh, it's a lot of them. Oh, yeah. Look at that. Look at that. Ooh-wee. Look at the list, y'all. Non-stop. There is an apostle for every home in America. Look at that list. Do y'all see this? That's the apostles list. On Facebook alone. Look at that. I promise you I did not plan to do this. Look at that, y'all. Look at that. I don't know how to stop this train. I don't know where to get off. Can somebody stop my computer from searching for apostles, please? Look at this. Ooh-wee. Male and female and probably some babies in here somewhere. Ain't this something? Wow. I'm telling y'all, I did not rehearse this. These are the apostles. Ain't that amazing? I could do that. I probably can do this all day long. Those are the apostles on Facebook. Now, where did they come from? Let's try to figure this out. Because apparently something happened for them all to pop up like that. Peace and blessings to you, Loretta Johnson. Missed you today in church. I know you out there doing work, though. If you ain't at church, you working. Yeah, look at that. Let's see if we can find out where all these apostles come from. Oh, man. You know, I don't know why I take on these challenges. I don't know why I do this. That's why y'all don't invite me to preach at your churches no more because y'all think I'm just too controversial. But I got the Sir Walter Jones Show, so I got more folks listening to me than that's going to be sitting in your church anyway. So I'm going to go this way. I will say, back in the 1970s and 80s, we had a whole bunch of bishops going into the 90s. Bishops. Everybody wanted to be a bishop. Everybody and their mama. Because that was the title. That was the position that was coveted the most. All right. In our churches, whether they were the Church of God in Christ, or whether it was a full gospel, or whether it was apostolic, okay, Assemblies of God, you saw the title of bishop. He that desire the office of a bishop desire a good thing. And that's what we preached, bishop, bishop, bishop. All right? And so it was a coveted position when I was coming up. All right? You went from being a minister to an elder to a pastor to the coveted bishop. All right? And you, if you was in the Church of God in Christ, you wanted to become a jurisdictional bishop. Okay? You get that? And then what started to happen is you wanted that title bishop, so they began to give what's called auxiliary bishops. These are titles. These are bishops that really don't have a charge. It's really an honorarium in a sense. Okay? So then what happened was something happened with somebody, because we only had a couple apostles, at least in Chicago. We had R.D. Hinton. Okay, we had Apostle, the other one here in Chicago. There was only about two or three apostles in Chicago who we honored, okay, as that title. We didn't question them. We didn't ask them who made you an apostle. They just became, and that's just the way it was. Y'all, I'm gonna be switching these glasses because I gotta. If they're not doing the work, then they are just fake news. That's what Cedric said. I didn't say it. Okay? All right. So then what happened was there was a wave of apostleship that hit the black church. Let me say this. If you notice, the apostleship is more in the black church that I notice. Now, I could be wrong. But I've studied religion around the world. I study because I have to teach, all right? That's my gift. But I noticed in the religions around the world, and I'm talking about those that are consider themselves Christianity, you will see almost exclusively that in the black church, thank you, Tony, Apostle Eckhart, in the black church, it is mostly apostles, all right? All these other churches, they still stick with bishop, or they may stick with missionary, they may stick with minister or elder or teacher or evangelist, okay? Or they'll stick with prophet, but they won't use apostle that much. But the black church, all right? We have overly used it. Now it gets to the point where now, when you are called into ministry, the Lord may be calling you in a missionarial type position, a place in your life where you go out and witness. But then someone of hierarchy will say, you are an apostle. And so what happens is they say, we're going to make you an apostle. And so I think what happened was that became the fad leading into the late 1990s, into the 2000s. Then before you knew it, we had an apostle popping up everywhere. And then before you know it, people started making themselves apostles. Okay, Apostle Clifford Turner. Thank you, Bronnie and Scott. Okay, so in Chicago, we only had Clifford Turner. We only had Eckhart. We only had Hinton, okay, and maybe one or two others, and that was it. And they were well known all over the country, if not the world. And then there was a big coveted of wanting to have that position. All right, now we know what the title means, all right. And if you look at what the title means, Dottie says the Apostle Jesse Garrett in St. Louis. That's right. Then if you see what the title means, and really all of us are apostles in a sense. All right. My pastor, Bishop Carlos Moody, refused to be called apostle. Okay? He refused to be called that. Although, he is the only apostle, real apostle, that I know today. There are other apostles out there. I think that many of the apostles that we see now have made the real ones, it devalued who they are, okay? I'm talking about the ones who are actually doing the work. I'm not talking about the ones that got five members and they're lording over these people and they don't do nothing outside of their church, okay? But my pastor, Bishop Carlos Moody, travels. He's been traveling most of his life since he was a teenager, and he travels to many countries around the world where it's 115 and 120 degrees, all right, and where the mosquitoes are all over the place, where there's not much food, where there's men with rifles and guns and warfare, where they have to pass through the gates, where they travel up, down, up mountains, where there's still steep mountains where there's nothing on this side, and there's just a little small road here, and they're traveling like this up and down, whether it's in Europe or whether it's in Africa, whether it's in Afghanistan, whether it's Iran, whether it's Haiti. Okay, my pastor has traveled to probably 61 countries and more. All right, he established churches and schools and places of refuge. So he's the only one that I know, okay? You know others, but he's the only one that I know who fit the position of an apostle. And he has birthed probably about 30 pastors so far. My pastor, he's literally birthed 30 pastors in the spirit realm. When I say literally, you know what I mean. In the spirit realm, 30 of them, they are around the world. But still to this day, he refused to be called that. He just said, just call me Bishop Carlos Moody. I want that. Very humble man. All right. And then you've got those who don't even have, they haven't even been out of their neighborhood, okay? They don't have, what's the paperwork that lets you get on the plane and go out of the United States? I think they call it a passport. They don't have a passport, okay? They don't know. Now, I'm not saying all apostles need to have a passport, because maybe your missionary journey might need to be here in America, okay? But I know some don't even have a driver's license. They just don't. They just right in this little hole right here, okay? And they call themselves apostle. All right, so I have notes here to see if I can figure out who are the true apostles, what are their positions, okay, and can we make sense of what the Bible says? See, because I'm not going to do a show about apostleship and don't use the scriptures on how Jesus handled the apostles, okay? A lot of them use these titles to get money from the folks lining their pockets. Well, yeah, that's true. I believe that as well. The word apostle means one who is sent out. You see, The Lord Jesus Christ, before he ascended, he descended into the lower parts of the earth, as the Bible said. And then what he did was he sent, when he came up, he gave gifts unto men. And these men were what we may call the fivefold ministry, all right? The apostle was the first one on the list. If this is the proper succession, then by all means, put the apostle at the top. And then, of course, the evangelist, prophet, a pastor, teacher, what have you. So those positions still, I do not believe that God got rid of the apostle, nor did he get rid of the prophet. He didn't kill off the prophet. He didn't kill off the apostle, because from from what we see here, he gave some apostles and some prophets, some evangelists. Everybody don't have an apostle in their church. He just gave some to the body, okay, for the perfecting of the saints, okay, to strengthen them up for the working, okay, so that they can go forth and do things and be strengthened. But as I go to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, he says, this is the Apostle Paul writing, now ye are the body of Christ and members in particular, he says, and God has set some in the church, first the apostle. You see? So I do not believe God killed them off. First the apostle, secondary the prophets, and then thirdly the teachers, the IES, y'all. And after that, then miracles, then gifts, then healings, then helps, then governments, then the diversities of tongues. All right. So he didn't kill off the tongues. He didn't kill off the prophet. He didn't kill off the apostle. Okay. And then here's the next question that he asked. Please pay attention to the next questions that the Apostle Paul asked in his letter to the Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and 29, he asked this question, and the way he asked these questions tell me that there's only one answer to all
of these questions. Number one, are all apostles? He asked the question, are all prophets? Are all teachers? Are all workers of miracles? Have all the gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? And the obvious answer is no. All are not apostles. I showed y'all the list. I could still, if we've been on this air already for 15 minutes, and I guarantee you, I could still be flipping and you'll see the apostle list, okay? I don't know who's real on that list. I don't know their lives. So I'm only talking about the people who are wearing these shoes and it don't fit, Cinderella. Then it says, but covet earnestly the best gifts, and yet show I unto you a more excellent way. Okay, this is, Effie Roth, how you doing? Because they want titles in churches. I know, I hear you. You are so right. You are on top of that right there. Dr. Mark Anthony Jones says it is not biblically sound, but monkey see, monkey do. Come on. Tony says true apostles are described as you say your pastor doing. I agree. Amen. Why are so many women apostles? I can't touch that. Having an apostolic anointing and being an apostle is two separate things. Mother Bernice, I want to talk about that. You see, there are some people who walk under the anointing or the office of something, and then there are people who God give to them temporarily. You see, I have the gift of teaching. That's what I do, 24 hours, and I'll go into a room. I'll have a whiteboard and a room filled with people, and I've done this with 1,000 people in a room. I'll go to the whiteboard, and the Lord will begin to drop into me things I never learned, things I've never read before. And I can teach a class for a whole hour and keep them on the edge of their seats on something I never studied in my life, because the Lord gave me at birth the gift of teaching. That's my office. I stand on it with all that I have, all right? And people who know me know. They call me. They say, Walter, help me out with this. And I've never studied it. I've had people who are psychologists. They're in school for psychology and psychiatry and all this stuff. And they call me, say, Walter, I'm stuck in my textbook. What does this mean here when yada, yada, yada? And the Spirit of the Lord would come over me. And then I would tell them what that means, okay? I would sit and counsel people on things, okay? And I don't have degrees on the wall, but the Lord has given me the gift. So there are people who are apostle only, they're entitled, or they walk in that office, they walk under that power, where when they walk in the room, you just know, you just see it. It's just evident in them. It's like E.F. Hutton. When he speaks, everybody listens. But then there are those who have that anointing that's attached to them, like Mother Bernice Williams says. And my pastor, he refused to be called an apostle, but he can refuse all he wants to. He's got the anointing to do that. So when he goes get on that airplane and go travel across the world, he's never been bit by a mosquito. And people hear him say that and laugh at him. But the Lord has put something in him where he'd been in places where he had elders and pastors, and they would put suits on, because they're on their way to Japan or China or someplace, okay? South America or wherever. And, you know, South America where all those mosquitoes are. And they be dressed. They be getting on the airplane with all their briefcases and 5 luggage and whatever. And Bishop Moody got this little thing, okay? And they like, okay, where we stand? We stand at the Hyatt? Are we staying at the Holiday Inn? He said, no, we stand in that little tent over there. You see the little tent right there with all the mosquitoes, and you want to go pee-pee? You want to go boo-boo? Well, in the back of that tent is a hole, all right? We'll cover our faces, and you can go do your little thing in that hole, you see? Because that's real ministry. And that's my bishop. That's my pastor. I don't even call him my bishop. He's not my bishop. He's my pastor, okay? And so he'll go into these places, and mosquitoes is biting all the elders, and they doing this, and they just, oh! And Bishop Moody be sitting there just sleep. Just sound. No mosquito bite. and it's 115 degrees, and he's just sitting there just calm and under the covers, okay? Because the Lord has given him the anointing. The Lord has shielded him from these distractions so he can go out there and do the work. You see, that's going to be 144,000 in Rome, in the book of Revelation, where God is going to shield them, protect them from danger and hurt and harm and death and all these, so that they could go out and evangelize. When you know, okay, you have the anointing to do something, you got the calling to do something, the Lord then prepares the way for you. You don't have to worry about the stress and the gossip and the scandal and all that stuff people throwing on you. No, God always opens up a way, okay, and protects you so that the work can be done. Because one thing God don't like is for his praises to be interrupted. Man, I can't do this to y'all today. Having an apostle. Oh, okay, let me flip this, because I bless him, love him, but I will take... Effie Ross says she'll take the Hyatt. Well, you can't travel with Bishop Moody, Effie, because I ain't there yet. That ain't my ministry. Keep me in America, okay? That ain't my ministry. On that airplane, and they're on the airplane for a day or two just to get to their destination. And this man is he in his 80s, all right? Okay, yeah, I'm stirring up stuff, Kevin. So the word apostle means one who is sent. In the New Testament, there are two primary uses of the word apostle. Two uses. Oh, now I might help y'all with some of your apostle friends, okay? There's two types of apostles. The first is specifically referred to the 12 of Jesus Christ. The second, though, is a general term referring to other individuals who are sent out to be messengers or ambassadors for Christ. So we used to be called ambassadors. Mm-hmm. Y'all know what an ambassador is? Woo-wee, I could teach that lesson about the ambassador. See, if your country makes you an ambassador, you are debt-free. All your bills are paid, and you even have some type of diplomatic immunity when you go over to some of these countries. See, because when you are an ambassador, you represent the country in whom you come from. You're like the governor, okay, who governs an area, because the governor represents the king. And whatever the governor listeth, whatever the governor says, it's like the king saying it too. Uh-huh. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So if you are an ambassador, then whatever you say, you speak for Christ. Mm-hmm. And so the United States sent out ambassadors, and those ambassadors must be debt-free. They can't have anything hovering over them, because that's a distraction on them. All right? So their bills are paid, and then when they go over there, they can do the work and not worry about the woes at home. And that's the way we're supposed to be in Christ. We're ambassadors, so when we go out and evangelize, why are you worried about stuff at home? You don't worry about the vicissitudes of life. Don't worry because it's raining or it's snowing outside or it's 100 degrees. No, you're an ambassador. All your spiritual debt is paid. Oh, man, I can't do this with y'all. Why did I get on that? So you are messengers. If you call yourself an apostle, then the term is messenger, missionary, or ambassador. And if you make yourself an apostle, or someone elevates you to the apostleship, then you must do the work and don't just hold on to the name for recognition purposes and bragging. Says, no, my name ain't Walter. My name is Apostle Jones. Put a respect on that. No, man. No, no, no. You ain't got to tell people what it is. The people supposed to see it in you. They're supposed to see the work and be changed by that. Come on, man, y'all. When Jesus walked into a room, Satan understood who Jesus was. Jesus didn't say, I am the Savior. I am the Lord thy God. I am the Alpha and the Omega. No, he didn't have to say nothing. When he walked in the room, Satan and those men, Satan said, oh, whoa, whoa, whoa. Hey, y'all know who that is? That's Jesus. As a matter of fact, when the sons of Sceva thought that they were holier than thou and trying to cast devils out, the devil in those boys said, wait, hold up, boys, Now, Jesus, I know him. Oh, trust me. I got some cousins who was pushed, who was cast into some swine, and they went swimming, all right? So I know Jesus. And then this Paul guy. Yeah, Paul I know as well, all right? But who the boop are you? You see, you're supposed to walk into a room and never say a word, and the spirit, all right, the discerning spirit in the person say, whoa, don't fool with that one. That's powerful right there. I think it was St. Francis of Assisi said, "It preach the gospel, but if need be, use words." You ain't got to say nothing. Yo, the anointing's supposed to be illuminating, and you're supposed to walk in the room, and they say, "Whoa, that's a bad brother. Who is it? I don't know who he is, but that's God's anointed right there." I've been to places. I've walked up and down grocery stores. I was in a restaurant with a table full of people. Everybody's dressed the same, all right? But when I got up and walked away, two women at the table says, "You are anointed. Are you a man of God?" I said, "Is it the suit?" She says, they said, "No, it ain't the suit, because everybody at the table wearing a suit. We don't even see the anointing, but with you, we see it." You see? And I didn't know how to act with that. I've been in grocery stores just buying some milk with some plain clothes on, just a t-shirt and some faded jeans. And then the walker to me says, "You are a man of God, aren't you?" I'm like, "How you know?" They say, "It's how you walk." The people are supposed to recognize the anointing in you, and you never have to put a title on your back. Oh, man. I don't know. T. Corey said, "Yes, God divinely confirmed Jesus' identity, and Jesus ain't never had to say nothing." That's the same with us. When we've divinely confirmed by God, we ain't got to say a word. T. Corey, you preaching this with me. All right? So y'all, please. I don't have a problem with people having positions. Not whatsoever. The Lord has given us the fivefold, and many of you have the anointing of the gift of helps and government and healings and tongues. Okay? That's your anointing. But you don't wear it on your shoulder. Christ didn't have to wear it on his shoulder. You see what I'm saying? So walk under that anointing. But you don't have to get all kinds. You see, my name on social media is Sir Walter Jones. Sir is just my business name. Ain't nothing anointed about sir. That's not an anointing. That's not a calling. That's a name that my constituents gave me. I didn't give myself that name. Everybody calls me sir. And I rejected it for years. And I finally said, "All right, sir is my name." But that's my business name. That's like my stage name. That's my product. That's my brand. But I'm Elder Jones. Y'all see this band collar here? There's no button there because I had my collar on today and my rope, okay? I have the title. I've paid the fee. I've been consecrated as an elder. But you don't see Elder Walter Jones on Facebook, do you? Nope. My name is just Sir Walter Jones because I didn't want to waddle in that stuff. I just didn't want to do that. That was my choice. I'm not going against those who got elder or pastor or apostle on social media, not whatsoever. But I'm just simply Walter. And when God talks to me, okay, when God talks to me, he calls me son. Yes, he does. He calls me son. Or he calls me Walter. He calls me by my birth name, all right? I see, y'all pray. Y'all pray, because I see one of our members, I see one of our friends here. I got the news on right now. It's 9 o'clock in the p.m. here on Fox News, and I just saw one of our members. I don't know what they're saying, but I'm going to see what this is. 2 dead, 4 hurt in shooting on the west side. God help us. Chicago is under attack, under war. Right, let's see what's going on here.
First arrived at the scene in East Garfield Park, they found multiple victims.
I believe it's six, 1023 Adam had 112 at Mount Sinai, and there was 3 at the crime scene, and then there was 2 more at Schroeder.
Chicago police say it appears the 6 men were standing outside when a car pulled up. Multiple shooters exited the vehicle and started firing at the group.
It's unfortunate that our children, who deserve the right to play in their neighborhood, to walk to their schools are being subjected to behavior that is not really humanly.
Police say two men, ages 27 and 23, were shot in the chest and died at Stroger Hospital. Three other men, all in their 20s, were shot and taken to Stroger in critical condition. The sixth victim was taken in good condition to Mount Sinai Hospital. Multiple shell casings littered West Van Buren, a known street to Alderman Jason Irvin, who believes the shooting was drug-related.
In the last probably 6 weeks, yeah. It had picked back up again.
I'm sorry, we do breaking news, okay? I saw Carolyn Anderson. Carolyn Anderson is one of our friends here. Sometimes she come on here. Pastor Michael Eady, his church is right there on the west side. Y'all know Pastor Michael Eady, I thought I'd let y'all see that. Pray for the families of those who were affected, okay? All right, so it says here the 12 apostles held a unique position. The 12, they held a unique position in referring to the New Jerusalem in Revelation 21 and 14. Now watch this. Your apostles' names are not in Revelation 21, only the 12. It says here, the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and on them were the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. Mm-hmm. The 12 apostles referred to in Revelation 21 and 14. Okay. It was these 12 apostles who were the first messengers of the gospel after the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. It was these 12 apostles who were the foundation of the church, with Jesus being the cornerstone, which is Ephesians chapter 2 and 20. You got that? The 12. The 12 was very important. One committed suicide, that was Judas. And then so the men came together to cast lots to see if they can replace him. And they discovered two men, and they picked Matthias because of the casting of lot. But notice, you didn't hear about Matthias all through the New Testament. It's like he disappeared. But Paul came on the scene, didn't it? Makes you wonder, was Paul the one that they should have chosen, or did God allow them to choose Matthias? All right, that's another story, because when you look into the apostles, many of them were not mentioned in the New Testament either. So there's a catch 22 here. This specific type of apostle is not present in the church today. The 12, okay? The 12. And if any of these apostles out there tell you they are part of the 12, all right? Then I'm sorry. They're not. They are not. The qualification of this type of apostles were, number one, to have been a witness of the resurrected Christ. Ain't no apostle today ever seen it. All right? That's 1 Corinthians 9 and 1. All right? They're going to write me some letters. I know they are, but I don't care. Number two, to have been explicitly chosen by the Holy Spirit. That's Acts 9 and 15. And number three, to have the ability, here's very important, to perform signs and wonders. All 12 of them perform signs and wonders. Acts 2 and 43. 2 Corinthians 12 and 12. All right? The role of the 12 apostles laying the foundation of the church would also argue for their uniqueness. 2,000 years later, we are not still working on that particular foundation. I need you to know that. All right. Jesus says you will drink deadly things. You'll drink poison and it will not harm you. A snake will come and bite you and it will not kill you. You will be able to raise the dead and all these things you'll be able to do. And I don't see nobody doing that today. All right. I just don't. I don't see nobody doing that today. Not under the name apostles. They may be doing it over in Africa. They may be doing it over in Europe. Okay. They might be doing it over in the land down under, but in America, because our faith has been waned, okay? Jesus could not do many miracles in that town. Why? Because of their faith. Can you believe that? Jesus Christ couldn't do any miracles? That's actually in scripture. He couldn't do them. The Bible says he did one or two in that town, and that city couldn't do no more because no faith. And that's America. Many are weak today and sleep. Sleep among you, Dottie Ledbetter is saying. Okay? Beyond the unique 12 apostles of Jesus Christ, there were also apostles in what's called a generic sense. Now, if you want the apostles that you have today, here are some of the generic ones. But Barnabas is referred to as an apostle in Acts 13:2 and in Acts 14. Andronicus and Junius are possibly identified as apostles in Romans 16:7. You got to look at the Greek word, everybody. The Greek word usually translated apostle is used to refer to Titus. But Titus was not the 12 among the 12, okay? But he is known as an apostle because of the Greek word used for Titus. You have to go to 2 Corinthians 8:23. And Epaphroditus in Philippians 2:25. These are the apostles that was not a part of the 12. So maybe your apostles today fit the general terms of the apostles we have here, all right? So maybe the phone call is going to kind of slow down a little bit because they're calling me. So there definitely seems to be room for the term apostle being used to refer to someone beside the 12 apostles of Jesus Christ. Anyone who was sent could be called an apostle. Just don't be changing your birth certificate to Apostle Baby Jones, all right? What exactly would be the role of apostle outside of the 12 apostles? Well, that's not really entirely clear, and that's the issue that we have today. From the definition of the word, the closest thing today to an apostle in the general sense is a missionary. Missionary. That's what my bishop, my pastor, Carlos Moody, is a missionary. When he goes to these many countries, he is a missionary. He don't walk up under the banner of apostle, okay? They refer to him as Missionary Moody, all right? A missionary is a follower of Christ who was sent out with the specific mission of proclaiming the gospel. A missionary is an ambassador of Christ to people who have not heard the good news. See, y'all are all apostles of people who have heard the gospel. Y'all keep trying to win the same people every Sunday. Your altars are filled with the same people every week. And many of them are saved folks, okay? And so Jesus said, it is not the well that seek a physician. He said, I didn't come for you. You already know me. I'm coming for the people who don't know me. So if you got these positions in your churches, all y'all doing is feeding, hand feeding, mouth feeding each other, and y'all ain't hungry. It's the people outside your church that's hungry. What sense does it make to go to school to be a physician for 10 years, okay, and spend thousands of dollars in tuition, and then all you want to do is work on another physician? So you go to a hospital and all the doctors are in the room cutting on each other trying to figure out how this works. And all of the sick people are sitting in the waiting room waiting on them. And then the doctors say, okay, we're done. And they say, amen. And then they close the doors, turn off the lights, and go home. Well, that's what happens in our churches every week. The same well people, the same spiritual people are trying to win each other, and you're already at one. Y'all are physicians trying to heal each other. Jesus said, physician, heal thyself. But the sick and the downtrodden and the poor and the needy and the orphans and the strangers, okay, and the fatherless and the motherless, all of them are outside your doors beating, trying to get in, and you're like, turn the music up, lock the doors, okay? We're in an ecclesiastical holy, 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 okay? And you high-fiving each other and you leave there and can't win a gnat. You can't even flap a fly off your dog, all right? And that's what's going on. This is the problem that Apostle Paul had. This is the same problem that Jesus had. Matter of fact, the disciples was jealous because there were other people trying to win folks to the Lord in another name. They were not a part of the 12 disciples, and the disciples were crying to Jesus, man, what are these people out here doing? You belong to us. It's like what white folks say, y'all don't have carte blanche on Martin Luther King. Who said that Martin Luther King only belonged to black people? Did you not hear his speech in 1963 when he was talking about "I Have a Dream"? He didn't say "I have a dream that all black people will be the greatest there ever was and down and deaf to the white folk." No, Martin Luther King belonged to all of us. Everybody, okay? So what Jesus like, who told y'all that I only belong to you? Okay. That's what I'm saying today. What exactly would be the role? Missionary, that's what you are. There are some today who are seeking to restore the position of the apostles. They're trying to restore that position. I get it. And some of you are moved in a dangerous position of being an apostle because you're making the real apostles look bad. Frequently, those claiming the office of apostles seek authority equal to or at least rivaling the authority of the original 12 apostles. And there is absolutely no biblical evidence to support such an understanding of that role today. You don't understand what them 12 went through. And this would fit with the New Testament warning against false apostles in 2 Corinthians 11 and 13. All right? So in a sense, all followers of Jesus Christ are called apostles. We all really are called apostles, pretty much because we're sent. We're missionaries. We're ambassadors, really what we are, all right? We are all to be his ambassadors, Matthew 28 and 18. Okay, we all are to be ones who are sent out. That's Acts 1 and 8. Okay, if this making any sense to you. Okay, so let's talk about what are the qualifications. Okay, Jesus Christ himself is an apostle. That's the greatest qualification right there. He wears an apostle as one of the disciples, the descriptive titles, that is, in Hebrews 3 and 1. He was sent to earth by his heavenly Father with God's authoritative message, which he faithfully delivered it. John 17 and 1. So you apostles, are you faithfully delivering the message of Jesus Christ and not the message of your church name? Not the message of your credentials? You see, because I see people getting up there and they spend more time defending their title than they are giving Christ what he is due. Man, I'm telling y'all, they about to ban me from social media. You see, I don't have a problem with women preachers. I don't have a problem with women pastors. I don't have a problem with women holding on to the five-fold positions. I ain't one of those guys. That ain't me. If a woman is doing the work, let her do the work, because so many of us men have walked away from the work. We've got caught up into all these other rituals. So I don't have a problem with a woman preaching and teaching. Not whatsoever. The Apostle Paul had many missionaries that were women that did the work. And he told them into those cities, welcome this woman and welcome this woman. And then there were those who were married, Aquila and Priscilla. Okay, they were married couple, all right? And they did help the brother. They made teach him a more perfect way in the Lord, Apollos, okay? So the women been doing the work ever since. It was the women who showed up at the garden when Jesus came out the tomb. You see, the men were at the house hiding from persecution. Tell them, hey, what? Whoa. They were in a witness protection, but the women were out there went there to clean the body of Jesus with the spices, okay? And then Jesus gave the first evangelistic work to the women. He said, now go and tell my disciples and that boy Peter. Come on, man. Y'all understand what's going on here? The women have had a huge place. It was the women that was cleaning, washed his feet. It was the women that were doing things for him and traveling with him, okay? I don't care what you say. So the women are doing the work today. Brothers, where are you? All right. So what I don't like what women sometimes do is they get up to preach and they spend too much time protecting their position or trying to qualify themselves. OK, trying to properly vet their position. We know you're a pastor. We know you are a preacher. Just get up there and do what Jesus did. Preach the gospel and sit down. When you spend 15, 20 minutes talking about how God called you to do this, then what you're doing is you not that confident. Because you got a whole bunch of men there, and they got their faces looking at you. And the Bible told the one brother, make your face as flint. Who cares what they look like? You preach the gospel. And if they don't receive you, take your shoes off. Because there's dust up under it, and just blow on your shoes. I don't care if it's 9-inch heels. Blow on them, sucker. And say, I don't want to walk in here no more. I ain't. And you take your shoes, put it in your purse. Y'all know how y'all do it. You put it across your back. Y'all know how y'all do it, ladies. And just walk out of that ministry. Just walk out of there and say, if they ain't going to receive the gospel, this women's shelter will, this men's shelter will, the penitentiary will, the jail will, the prison will, the soup kitchen will, the men and women on the corner will. That house over there will. I can go house to house. You ain't got to be validated by no man, ladies, to preach the gospel. Ain't too many men gonna tell you that. Don't be using the whole donkey in the ass thing. If the God can use a donkey, he can use me. Stop using that, ladies. You're making yourself look silly, and men always laugh at you when you say, if God can use a donkey. Stop referring to yourself on the equal level as an ass. You ain't no ass. All right? You are a woman of God, and God has sent you out to do an evangelistic work. You are an ambassador, you are a missionary, and you do the work, and stop Xeroxing your paperwork. We don't have to see that. Do the work, and dress in modest apparel, and stop wearing stuff that make people distracted, because some of us men, we don't know how to act with our eyes. Okay? We see y'all, and we can't hear the gospel because we're too busy seeing how you dress. And so we don't know how to receive the gospel. So Jesus fixed that. The Apostle Paul fixed it. He told you about modest apparel. Because you're going to go into places, ladies, where there's a whole bunch of men. All right? And you know that God has blessed you with a body. He blessed you with breasts. He blessed you with all kinds of things and long flowing hair, or maybe bald. You're sexy to some guy, no matter what your shape is, and you should know how to dress, or you can't get the gospel out there. Because men, look, men are like fountains. We're always sprouting out. And you walk by us and the perfume wakes us up. And I ain't talking about nothing above the head. We wake up. Our stocks are looking up to the moon, Alice. We have a future in the stars, okay? We wake up when the sun, come on. So ladies, adorn yourself respectfully so that the gospel can go forth and we can receive it. But see, I've been in pulpits where the woman get up there to do what she do, and there's nothing but stuff in my face. And you know your body's shape, and you put certain clothes on because you want to get attention. So what does that say? You are not that confident in your walk. All right? So wear something compared to your body shape. I do it. I'm a skinny man. I'm a skinhead man. And you will not find me wearing the tightest, most tight. I don't put stuff on where you can see my bone marrow, okay? I don't put stuff on so tight where you can see the heart beating. You're supposed to be able to feel my heart. You're not supposed to be able to see my heart beating. Come on. You're not supposed to see that I had some chicken just 2 hours ago and it's up there in my lower intestines. Come on, with these, after all, them skinny jeans. You're looking like a clown. I don't want to see you behind, brothers, okay? So wear some looser clothes so that I can look at you as a man and not like something that's trying to be a, well, you know what I mean? I don't want to see your blood type. I don't want to know that you are O positive. I mean, that's how tight your clothes is. Come on, man. I'm looking at the front of you, but I see your spine. I mean, how's that possible? Okay? Come on, please. Wear something looser so that I can enjoy the fellowship with you and preach the gospel. And stop sashaying around my church or your church because you want people to see how much you paid for. I don't care if you got a Steve Harvey coat on or Louis Vuitton shoes. It ain't about that. We're just too distracted on Sunday. So we spend 40 minutes in church when we walk in there because everybody looking at everybody is what they wearing and how much, what type of cologne they got on and perfume and your hair. We waste too much time and God is sitting there like, I'm waiting. I'm waiting. I hear y'all singing, but you singing, yeah, I can't hear the singing because y'all trying to figure out who doing the most fanciest run. Okay, who's playing the most fanciest chord on the piano? Who's got their little Facebook and their social media thing looking at me? Look at me play. Look at me, I'm doing my runs. Y'all don't catch me doing that. When I go to church and worship, it's almost like private worship because I don't put my social media in there and let everybody see what I'm doing. I just don't. The people in the room, they're there. They see me. So if you want to hear me play, okay, come to my church and hear me play. But except somebody else is filming me, I don't film my Sunday morning services when I'm playing the piano. I will film the gospel. If they make me speak, I'm going to film it because there are people out there who call me pastor and I minister to them. But when it comes to me playing and while the choir, I just prefer not to do it. That's my choice. I don't want to do it. Somebody else does it, but I don't do it because when I'm playing, there is this thing that I have with Christ. Me, he and I got this thing going on because I am Mr. Jones. You know, me and him got a thing. All right. And when I'm playing, sometimes I forget that y'all are even in the room. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's horizontal. Yes. But it's really vertical with me. And I'm playing chords that I forget. I don't even pay no attention to it. And I'm just enthralled in my worship with Christ. And somebody say, hey, Walter, play that chord again. I'm like, what you talking about? What chord? I don't know what you're talking about. This ain't time for lessons. This is time for worship. I ain't got time to give you a piano lesson. I'm here to worship like you. I ain't here to serenade you. Okay? This is corporate worship. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving. Enter into his courts with praise. Y'all keep saying that, quoting it, and singing it. Now you want to turn this into a competition, a piano lesson? A run, telethon, God ain't taking, he don't want none of that, all right? Matter of fact, how did I get on this? I don't know, y'all. I don't know how I got on this tip, but I'm going to tell you what God said to the children of Israel. Let me tell you what he said. Y'all want to hear what he said? He said, hear the word of the Lord, ye rulers of Sodom. Give ear unto the law of our God, ye people of Gomorrah. To what purpose is the multitude of your sacrifices unto me? Mm-hmm, saith the Lord, I am full of burnt offerings. He said, I'm full of it. I done heard enough of it. Of rams and fat of the fat beast. And I delight not in the blood of bullocks or of lambs or of he-goats. I don't want no more of it. He said, when you come to appear before me, who hath required this at your hand to tread my courts? Who told you to come to church? Who told you to come? Because what's your purpose of coming here anyway? God said, bring no more vain oblations, incense, no more communion Sundays. Keep that grape juice at home and them stale crackers. He said, don't bring that stuff in here. It's an abomination unto me. The new moons and the Sabbaths and the calling of assemblies and the Church of God in Christ, holy convocations and the Baptist conventions and the apostolic creeds and the assemblies of God, convocations and stuff. He said, I don't want none of that. He said, I cannot. He said, away with it. It is iniquity. Even the solemn meetings that y'all be having, I don't want it no more. This is in the Bible, y'all. I'm not making this up. This is Isaiah chapter 1. He said, your new moons, your pastor's anniversaries, your usher's anniversaries, your choir anniversaries, okay, your midnight musicals, these are your new moons and your appointed feasts, my soul hateth. They are troubling to me. I am weary to bear. He says, and when you spread forth your hands, holy, 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 I will hide my eyes. He said, I don't want to see it. Mm-mm. I hide my eyes from you. Yea, when you make many prayers, y'all praying, and you husbands are not faithful to your wives, and you beating your wives, or you just ignoring your wives, you don't care about your wives, the Bible says that your prayers will be hindered. You pray all night long. God says, I ain't listening to you take care of your wife. Listen to her. I'm a witness to it. If I had just listened to myself talk years ago, I'd still be married. If I had just paid attention to myself right now. Mm-hmm. And when you spread forth your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. Yea, when you make many prayers, I will not hear. Your hands are full of blood. All right? You saw people do things and they're not supposed to do. And so their blood is on your hands. Wash you. Make you clean. Put away the evil of doing from you before my eyes. Cease to do evil. Learn to do well. Seek judgment. Relieve the oppressed. Go out there and relieve them. They are oppressed. They're hungry. They're starving. They need help. And we in church, I'm a traveling shoe. Lord, you got on my traveling. Really? God says, I don't want none of that. Shut up. Relieve the oppressed. Judge the fatherless. And plead for the widows. They are suffering. They can't pay the mortgages. The husband dead and left her in debt. Come now. This is God saying, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sin be scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. I mean, this is some great stuff here. I mean, he's talking about that your skin is putrefied. He said, you ever got a wound on your skin and it wouldn't heal? That's what God is saying. He says, you're like a wound that can't heal. And then when it can't heal, it began to smell. And that's why he used the word putrefied. How did I get on this subject? I have no idea. All the apostles of Chicago are headed to the Sir Walter Jones Show. Woo! Lord have mercy. I can't do this with y'all today. And it's hot in here. Okay, so Jesus was the best apostle that we can think of because he was representing his Father and his Father's word. While Jesus was here on earth, he personally selected from his many followers 12 men and gave them an apostleship, special responsibility to receive and spread his message after he returned. Okay, one of the 12 was Judas Iscariot, who betrayed Jesus to his enemies. In agony of conscience, Judas hanged himself. Matthew 27:5. Thus, when Jesus returned to heaven, he left behind only 11 apostles when he left. All right. Some days after that, the remaining apostles were in Jerusalem. They were praying with Jesus' mother. There's a woman again, y'all. Judas, okay, I'm sorry, his brothers and other believers, okay, they were all together. And the group totaled about 120. We know the story, Acts 1. Simon Peter addressed the group and told them that Psalm 69:25 predicted Judas' desertion. And Psalm 109:8 predicted that the defectors placed among the apostles should be filled. The apostleship must fall to someone else. If I had a hammer and organ, I'd be So Peter proposed choosing a new apostle and set the qualifications. Not everyone could be considered for an apostleship. Candidates needed to have been with Jesus. Did you hear that? Yeah, with Jesus during the whole 3 years that Jesus was among them. That is, he needed to be an eyewitness of Jesus' baptism when the Heavenly Father validated Jesus' person and work. He needed to have heard Jesus' life-changing teachings and been present to see his healings and other miracles. Did y'all hear that? He needed to have witnessed Jesus' sacrifice himself on the cross and to have seen Jesus walk, talk, and eat among the disciples again after his resurrection. These were the pivotal facts of Jesus Christ, his life, the heart of the message they were to teach, and personal witness were required to verify the truth of the good news. That's why everybody could not be an apostle. I gave y'all two types of apostles, remember that, all right? The prayer group and Jerusalem nominated two who met these qualifications, Joseph, Barsabbas, and Matthias. Okay? And then the disciples asked God to guide them to know which one to fill that post. And using a method of determining God's will that was common in that time, It was not gambling. For those of you who we did that show already, the casting of lots was something that God allowed. Okay? This giving God freedom to make his choice clear, the lot fell to Matthias, and he became the 12 apostle. Got that? I'm in trouble. They're coming after me. And I don't care. I don't care. Good teaching, young man. Thanks for letting the Lord use you. Thank you, Effie Roth. Thank you. And I think it's a congratulations in order. Did y'all win a Stella or something over there at Urban Praise? Over there with Moody and Effie? Did y'all? I heard something. I was listening to Moody on the way to church today. Okay? Please, people. I'm going to close this out. Please, 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 please. After hearing this show, don't go over and talk to these apostles and say, Sir Walter said, you are fake because you wasn't a part of the 12. Please don't do that. Don't do it. So let me reiterate. It'd be best that you show them this video and let them rewind this tape. Okay? Please. There are those who are the 12. All right? You won the Stella a few years ago. Okay, Effie. All right. Y'all should win it again. Because that's one of the greatest shows in America. That don't make no sense how good that show is. That station is. Not just a show. That station, I mean. There are many apostles out there. All right? Some, I will say, elevated themselves to that position. Some went online, on the internet, paid a fee, and they got their certificate of apostleship. All right. And they've gone out into the world, and God has called them a thief. You're like, huh? Yeah. The enemy, they are thieves. You see, when a man or a woman comes in from the roof, when they come in through the back door, when they come in through the window, when they come in through the basement, they are thieves. You see, they don't come in through the front door. They just, boom, they just popped up out of nowhere. They're thieves. And this thief, all right, he comes to kill. He comes to steal. He comes to destroy. All right? Now, when we hear that message, we always think about Satan. We always say, and Satan comes to kill. Well, yeah, he does come to kill, steal, and destroy. But in this particular story, he's talking about these false apostles, false preachers, false teachers, false prophets, the ones who didn't come in through the gate. They're thieves and robbers, and they're coming to rob you. All right? Beware of them, and you ask God to help you. The gift of the discerning of spirit supposed to wake up in you, and you supposed to say, mm-mm, that's fake news right there. That's a Donald Trump of spirit right there. That's fake news, okay? And turn around and walk away from that. All right, they're thieves. Watch them. And then there are those who have been doing the work. They didn't just pop on the scene to do a work today, now the apostle. No, they have gone through the trenches. They got seniority, if you said alternative facts, okay? And they've been doing the work. You've been seeing them do the work for a long time. And you look back in their lives and you see the residue of their work. Many of them walk under the anointing of the apostleship. They have an apostolic anointing, and they set things in place. They establish missionary work. And I ain't talking about those who start churches. Can I say this? Can I say this and get in trouble again? God don't need another church building built. Nowhere in America, okay? He don't need another church building. Is we got one, we got too many, further up. We got too many churches. Too many. come to Chicago and drive up and down my street. Well, the street after my street. It's called Michigan Avenue. And I want you to start at 95th in Michigan. And I want you to drive south down Michigan from 95th Street to maybe 119th Street. All right? Here's what you're going to see on Michigan Avenue. You're going to see a whole lot of abandoned buildings. All right, number one. Number two, you're going to see a whole lot of businesses that's not ours. I'm talking about Asian, okay? I'm talking about Indian, okay? All right? You ain't going to see many of us, hardly ever, all right? Number three, you're going to see a major chain like a Walmart or a Family Dollar, all right? All right. Number four, you're going to see some greasy spoons, maybe barbecue or something like that. Yeah, you're going to see that. Number five, you're going to see one of them corner stores where you walk in there and there's a bulletproof windshield there. And there's an Indian on the other side and he's selling everything from loose squares to paraphernalia where you can smoke your all kind of stuff. If you want a tampon, he'll go in the box and open it up and give you one tampon. He'll sell you whatever you want. If it's some money involved, he will sell it to you one out of the box. You want a cookie? All right, he'll go into the package and give you one cookie for a dollar. All right, that's in your neighborhood. All right, now that over there, number four, I done lost count. Well, number five, what you gonna see from 95th, AP Deli, thank you, Bronia. From 95th to 119th is a church. And you may not be able to leave the block unless you see a church. And not only will you see a church, they sharing each other's wall. That's how I know. They right across from each other, and they sharing the wall. That means they got to knock on the wall to tell the musician to turn it down because this musician can't be heard in this church. And they, some of them are part of the same denomination. This is first jurisdiction and this is sixth jurisdiction. They got the same wall, okay? Two different bishops. And they said traveling shoes, quiet. We trying to send traveling shoes in C-sharp. I'm telling y'all. All right, there's a church here, church there, church there, church there, all up and down Michigan Avenue. And the reason why I say God don't need another church building is because from 95th to 119th in Michigan, some of y'all are too scared to drive down that street. Some of y'all are too scared to walk down that street. You're too afraid to get out of the car to go into AP Deli because you're afraid you're going to get shot or raped or mugged or robbed. But there's a church on every corner. How can the people of God be that present on Sundays? If you walk, trust me, I live only one block east of Michigan Avenue. And they park all the way over there almost, and they park on my street because it's so many churches there. They line up Michigan Avenue, line with cars all up down Michigan Avenue. So they got to park down right where I live. When I see all these cars pop up on Sunday morning, I say, well, the church folk, okay, they're here. But Monday through Saturday, you can park anywhere, at any time, at any moment of the day. And those churches got bars on them. Click, lock, Roxy! Okay, they locked down with a guard. Come on, y'all. Locked. They got ADT alarm service. They got that black dude that stand on the in your front lawn I dare you to try. Y'all know that commercial? Yeah, he's standing there. I dare you to come in this church. Yeah. Mm-hmm. All kind of security alarms going off.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a white church, okay? Well, they kind of mix. It's a white church. Oh, one, they mixed. And guess what I see when I'm out there walking? I see a bunch of people lined up against that church with empty bags and carts. Guess what that church is doing? They're feeding the hungry, and they're helping people get jobs, okay? They're helping people get shelter. We got lockdown, but that church where them white folk are, I see them folk lined up out there getting food. In my heart, I always get teared up when I see that. I say, wow. So sometimes I have my dog, so I can't walk over there, but I just want to drop the dog and go over there and put on some gloves and get in that kitchen and do some work. Yeah, open and working 7 days a week, Effie says. God don't need another church building. He don't need another mega church. He don't need another building fund. He don't need none of that. No. We just building church houses for ourselves. That's all we doing. And the neighborhood is still crime ridden, but we got all those churches. What is that saying to the world? Why you think the world tease y'all the way they do? Why you think that they can make fun of your Lord and Savior the way they do, but they won't do that to the Muslim? You notice that? They're afraid to even joke about Muhammad. Can't even make a cartoon caricature because the Muslims don't play that. See, they say, oh no, we going to heaven early. You mess with our God. But Christians, we laugh when they make fun of Jesus. We laughing with them. All right. I'm in trouble. I need witness protection from the apostles. All right? So God has established the apostolic. He built the church on the apostles. He built it on the apostles and the prophets. He built the church on that. So he didn't kill that. He didn't kill the apostles. There's some great men and women out there doing the work. Apostle David Rogers is one of them. My dear friend, his church is right up the street from my house. He always over there doing work, going up and down the street and buying these abandoned buildings and help moving some of the single mothers into those places. He's teaching generational wealth for black people, black finances, putting our monies where we're supposed to put it. He's got the apostolic anointing on him. And too many people that I know are doing that. But everybody, I'm gonna show y'all the list here again. Okay? Now, at the beginning of this show, I was scrolling down all of the apostles. All right? Let me see if it's been scrolling ever since. Okay? It's been scrolling ever since. These are apostles, y'all. They're there. Look at that. Look at that. I can go all night. Look at that. I can play a hymn. I can do a concert. Fly to Florida, have dinner with the president and Mar-a-Lago, and come back 2 weeks later, and the list will still be fresh. Look at that. Effie said one looked like he's 21. Now, I need you to look at the color scheme, though. Y'all see the color scheme? Look at that. Ooh-wee. I want to stop, y'all. I'm telling you, I want to stop. My God, today. Oh, man. A never-ending list. Never-ending. Never-ending. And 99.99% of them are African-American. Why? Because that's what we do. When we find a fad, we stick to it. Money cometh to me. Y'all remember that fad? Money cometh to me. And when y'all jumped on that thing, folk was going filing bankruptcy. They were losing their houses and all kind, because all they did was went to church and said, money cometh to me. And nobody went home and got a hold of their finances. They just thought they could say a magical word and money just automatically show up in their bank accounts. Y'all don't remember that stuff. Y'all don't remember that stuff. And that is the trick. You see? They're coming in from the roof. They come in from the back door. They come in the window. And they say, money cometh to me. And they know you sheep, because sheep are dumb. Sheep vulnerable. And when we see a new fad, we run. You see, somebody set up a church in your town, and you notice a whole bunch of people running to that church. When you see a crowd of people running somewhere, it is innate in us to run with the crowd. Mm-hmm. You don't even know why they're running. You don't know if they're running to something or they're running from something. It don't matter. They're running, and you better run, or something's going to happen to you, or you're going to miss something. So we run with the crowd. Mm-hmm. I put up a post the other day and I asked the question, would you rather be pushed or pulled? In fact, go ahead and answer that question. Answer it, for those of you. Maybe you didn't see it. What would you rather be? Would you rather be pushed or would you rather be pulled? Mm-hmm. I'm going to preach that one day. All our cousins, Tacoa said, I still say it sometimes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Tony, you says 99% are not. I'm going to say it. Come on. 99% of these people on this list are black. I saw a couple white people. If you want to be pulled, all right? Amen. I hear you. Pull me. I like that. Some people say push. I would love to hear why you would want to be pulled. I would like to hear that. Lilydale Baptist. Yeah, Abronia, Lilydale Baptist is probably the biggest building on 107th in Michigan. It's been there forever, but you're right, Lilydale. As far as Michigan is concerned, that I can see in my head, I think it's the oldest and it's the largest. Yeah, right across the street. Absolutely. And that's Michigan Avenue. You know, I'm not even going to talk about Indiana Street. If you have to start at 111th in Indiana and travel south, and you're going to see another whole bunch of churches on Indiana Street. And Reverend Meeks was one of them. I think he was 118th in Indiana. Now he's got close to the mega church over there. But, oh yeah, up and down Indiana. Start at 111th. That's where those churches start. Okay? All right. Okay. Well, I'm going to stop now because I think this has gone long enough. If you got any questions, go ahead and put it in the comment area. I don't have to be pushed or pulled as long as you giving me truth. Van Zale, that's good. Because there are others who said they don't want to be pushed or pulled. They answered like you. But I will tell you a secret. Everybody's pushed or pulled. Every one of you, whether you like it or not. You are being pushed or pulled by someone or something. Because God chases you. You see, you can't even go to Christ except God draw you. So how does he draw you? Does he draw you by pulling you or pushing you? Because if you're pushing someone, are you pushing them away or are you pushing them into their destiny? Which one it is? So you don't have to answer push or pull, but you're being pushed or pulled. I just need you to know that. All right. I don't go anywhere just because everyone else is going. You might have to pull me. Effie, boy, we're going to have a cup of tea and just talk about life. I'd rather be pushed or pulled as long as the old E pushing and pulling me to go. Okay, good. Pushing you to your destiny. Amen. Amen. Tony Harris. Preach. Preach that gospel. All right. I was getting ready to say something. I can't remember what it was, but maybe that means I need to just stop. It's a sad day when people go to church for help and they're sent away to a different church. What is that saying about that ministry? All right. My pastor this morning was talking about how he had a prayer meeting every Sunday from 6 to 7. He didn't have the meeting. He put someone over it, and they would pray from 6 to 7. It was a woman. And then the prayer got good, and they went from 6 to 8, okay? And then they went from 6 to 9. And then, so before you knew it, she had her own ministry going on because church was supposed to start at 11 o'clock that day. So when 11 o'clock came, the people stopped coming because they had had all the church they needed from 6 to 9 from that woman. So she had her own ministry going on. She wasn't even the pastor, you know. And so these are things that happen. And so when stuff like that happens, these people, offense happen, and then these people leave and start their own little missions, okay? Their own little covenants and things like that. Their own little new life ministries and all these other things, okay? And then they branch out and they do their things, and maybe they succeed and maybe they fail, and depending on if the Lord called them or not. But I'm not going to, right here in Chicago, we have men of God. I will not say no names because I'm just not the name-dropping kind of person, all right? But we have men of God in Chicago right now, pastors who are jealous of each other. My dog's bigger than your dog. My congregation is bigger than yours, you see? So what has happened is the pastors, some of the pastors here saying they're bidding their people from visiting those churches that seem to be growing by leaps and bounds because they're afraid that if they go over there, that man is going to win them. So what does that say? That says a couple things. Number one, how inadequate are you?
Lord have mercy.
How inadequate are you? Your teaching for where your people, the flock that God has given, okay, the children of God, because they really ain't your children, they God's children, but help me here, all right? It ain't your church, it's God's church, all right? But I hear what you say when you say, I told my people, I get that. They God's people, but I get what you're saying, all right? How inadequate are you in your teaching where the people, when somebody come to town or somebody established the work and they go over there one time and they give you a letter say, I ain't coming back. You know, like, put your mama on the phone. Yeah, hey, baby, I ain't never coming home. You know, that's what some of y'all, that's what they're afraid that y'all gonna do. All right, so that's number one. How inadequate are you? Number two, who said that these people got to be a part of your church until they die, and then their bodies begin to stink like Lazarus? Who said that they got to live a life under your tutelage and their next generation? Who said that God didn't push or pull them out of your cranky hand into the arms of someone else? Soos, all right? So you can't be jealous because another man is doing a great work, all right? And he pulled, if really, did he pull them? They got their own minds. It's up to them whether they want to hear another gospel or the same gospel just presented in a different way. I don't always want to go to Applebee's. Even though I can get some ribs there, they're okay, but Chili's got the best baby back ribs I've had, you see? Unless I'm going down to Carson's, I'll get some Chili's ribs, right? Ribs is ribs, but you ain't going to catch me at McDonald's getting that nasty McRib. I might as well take some cardboard and tear it up and put it in a bowl chop it up, and put some cyanide in the bowl, and stir that up, okay? And tell my dog to vomit in the bowl, and then stir that up, all right? And then find some bone from the garbage can, and put that in there, and freeze it, all right? And then 24 hours later, take it out and put it in the oven, and put some barbecue sauce on it. Thank you, Effie. Mm-hmm. And then I bite into that sucker and say, this McRib sure is good. Okay? Ain't nothing but horse, a dead horse meat. Okay, that's what that is. So, pastors, how insignificant. All right? See, I'm a musician. I don't consider myself, others consider myself an anointed minstrel. All right? Spiritual Levite, in a sense. And when I pick up that thing right there, that's my piano. When I play that, people say that prophecies come forth. And people, I've heard people say that they got healed through playing. All right? But when I go to some concerts, some churches, I hear some of the most accomplished musicians I've ever heard in my life. And they're 10, 15 years younger than me. And they could kill that piano, all the chords. And they just be making that thing sing. And sometimes I feel inadequate. And I say to myself, I need to go back to the drawing board. Those guys are playing. Ooh. And I say, I ain't playing no more. I quit. I retired. And the Lord always rebuked me. Because the Lord said, he has let me know, I gave you that. I gave him that. That's his. I gave you that. Right? And when you play, I've given you a package. Right? You affect people this way. See, this guy right here, I look at some people who are in ministry, they are the ones who can reach these people. But this guy who's doing the same thing can't reach those people. But they're doing the same thing. You see? So, he says, I gave you that to reach those people. It ain't about those people. See, those people are looking for that guy and his. But those people are looking for your evening manna when you sit there at 11 o'clock at night and the sisters or the brothers are up wondering how am I going to pay this bill tomorrow and they're going to shut my lights off in another 24 hours and I'm going to work and they told me if I'm late one more time, they're going to give me a pink slip and my son or my daughter is just so disobedient. I don't know what I'm going to do and my head ache and my body ache and I don't know how I'm going to make it through this thing here. And they turn on your evening manna and hear you play the hymns that God has given the men and women to write. And they hear you play them. And the saints come forth in praise and giving God the thanks. And they go into a spirit of prayer and warfare and intercession while you yet play. God says, I gave that to you. And it don't take no fancy nothing what that guy is doing. It's fancy for the fancies. What I gave you is psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, and you play it under the anointing. So now when I go into these places and I hear the band killing it, I enjoy it. And then I go home and says, all right, but I'm going to play what God has given me. And that's what you need to be reminded of. God has given you something unique that he's given nobody else. It don't matter if he called you on the same title, whether it's missionary, ambassador, apostle, bishop, pastor, teacher, whatever it is. It don't matter about the title, but he's given you a special anointing. And only you can operate in the way you do. And there are going to be thousands affected by what you do. Let that man and woman do what he does. That's what he does. These pastors who are popping up, these new pastors popping up in Chicago, and they before you know it, they got thousands of members. God gave that to them. You've got 25 members. He gave that to you. Hold on to that. Do the work that he's placed in you with the 25. He got 10,000. That's what God gave him. Why you want to be? Because if he gave, if I gave you the 10,000, it might fail because I didn't give you a 10,000 ministry. I gave you a 25 ministry. That's why everybody's talking about, I want to be rich. Well, you ain't rich today. You may never be rich because maybe God don't want you to be rich because he know you. He know how you roll. He wants you to be a thousandaire. Because with a thousand, he knows that you know how to manage that and work it in the ministry. Build the kingdom with a thousand. Because I can't tell you how many people won the lottery, $1 million, and in 3 months, the millions dried up. There's a show called 30 for 30, I think it's called. It's a sports show, I think it's called. Well, they did a show where these NFL players, multimillionaires, they have multimillion-dollar contracts, and they lost it all. They now poor, they're broke, and filed for bankruptcy after having multi-million-dollar contracts. Gone. Wiped out. Y'all go on YouTube and type that in. I think it's 30 for 30 on ESPN, one of them, okay? Anyway, and I'm watching that, and I just wanted to faint. I could not believe that these men were spending their money, and it's gone. A fool and his money will soon part. So the gift that God has given you, use it, even if it only affects five people. Those five people God assigned to you. I have mine right here. When I turn on Facebook Live, the same people come and we talk. The same people. Every now and then, some other stragglers come by. They'll tune in and they may leave. But that dedicated force that God has given me, my friends, though my listeners, they come. No matter what time of day it is, they stop by. Because the Lord has linked us up. Mm-hmm. Those are mine, and I'm theirs. And that's the way it is. They know my brand, and I know theirs. When someone else goes Facebook Live, they'll have 500,000, 2,000, 5,000 people. And I used to get jealous of that, not no more. Because what is the adverse effect of the 5,000 after the show is over? It don't affect me. I have no idea, so it don't affect me. But the 17 that's watching right now, many of my close followers, they always tell me how it affects them. I'll get an inbox message, I'll get a text message, I'll get somebody on my Facebook commenting on the message, I'll get a phone call if they got my number, or what I've been getting lately is money in the mail, and I don't ask for it. Didn't ask for it. It's from somebody who said, Walter, I want to bless your ministry. And I says, okay, because I don't know how to ask for money for this. For playing the piano and going and doing stuff. Trust me. I can ask for money. You want me to come what? Here's my expense. Here it is. I ain't got a problem with that. But when it comes to the gospel, I'm sorry. I don't ask for money. But when somebody said, give me your address, you have that certain app, you have Giveify on your app, you have the Cash app, do you have PayPal and all that? They says, because we want to bless you. When I see stuff like that, I say, wow, God, I didn't even ask for that. He says, I know you didn't ask for that. Because you're faithful in a few things, right? And you're doing it for free. Burning these lights, tearing up your phone. I got a cracked phone right here. I got to help get that thing changed, okay? And all kind of stuff going on over here. And I'm paying money for this. And then my teachings and my studies, and sometimes I'm being here sweating and coughing in front of y'all and all this stuff, and just getting sick sometimes for free. And God says, you're faithful over a few things. I'm making rule over many. And they're going to bless you because I'm going to make sure they do. And I thank God for that. So this is my ministry. If you want to be an apostle, by all means, do you. Okay? But you better be careful. God's watching you. And the people of God ain't as stupid as you think they are. The saints are very savvy today. They're studying more than they never done before. And they are wiser now. They're sharper now. And they're reading the Bible. Many of my friends are reading the scriptures and they say, oh, you mean to tell me I thought this was that all that time? So, they know y'all now. The game is up. They're not dummies. Okay. All right, apostles. God, we thank you for your spirit. Your spirit. Your spirit. Your spirit. Lord, don't take your spirit from me. Thank you for the people of God here, the ones who are listening and the ones who will listen tonight and tomorrow and further on, the thousands that will come. God, I thank you for the numbers of the people who hear the gospel. They will receive it or they will reject it. It's up to them, God, but you continue to give me the knowledge, the gift of wisdom and knowledge on what to say, how to apply it so that the people might be blessed. Those who are doing the work of the apostleship, continue to bless their ministries and send them out, God. Make them messengers. Make them missionaries and ambassadors for your name, that they might remove their flesh and their own understanding. Let them lean on you and the gospel of Jesus Christ, that they might win many, those who have not heard the gospel. Help them. And God, I'll support them in any way I can. We love you for it. We give your name the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Y'all go ahead and hit the share button if you can. Hit that share button. There's 19 on here now. If you just hit, boom, share, this message will go out to the people and it will help give them an understanding of who they are. And you might start seeing that apostle. Let's get a little... Okay, let me stop messing. All right, Lord, please continue to bless your vessel with manna from heaven to enlighten your people. Amen, Melissa. Thank you. DeAndre, Duncan, blessings to you. Amen, blessings, miracles, peace, strength, health, wealth, and favor. I love you, Mom, Lamaria, and your whole family. Jacqueline, Elaine Coleman, blessings to you, my dear, 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 long, long, long time friend. Rosalind Walls Collins Dobson, the longest name in American history, is here. I love her. Y'all put a mic in her face, and she will make you faint. The woman can sing like angels. Amen. All right. I love you guys. I was going to do evening manna, but I think I'm tired now. So I guess this is my manna because I'm just tired. My keyboard, this has been too long anyway. All right. We'll do manna tomorrow. All right. Pray for me, guys. I'm going to eat something. Love you. Hit the share button. If you're on YouTube, hit the subscribe button. Peace to you.